Now let's talk about laws and regulations. As an IT and cybersecurity professional, you need to understand the laws and regulations that are in the area that your company works in and that you need to adhere to, because it's going to have a huge impact on your work. So to begin with, we have criminal law, and that is where most cybercrimes fall under. With criminal law, society is the victim, and the proof in those cases must be beyond a reasonable doubt. The punishment, if convicted, can range all the way from financial fines through incarceration and finally death penalty. And the sentence here is to punish and deter. So you punish whoever did it and you deter someone else from doing it. And I have had some students that question, yeah, but hacking, death penalty, doesn't that seem a little bit extreme? And in most cases, I completely agree. If they steal social security numbers or credit card numbers, if they do a DDoS attack, the server's down, sure, that's definitely not something where we would use the death penalty. But what if they hack into a nuclear power plant that melts down and 100,000 people die? Or they, on purpose, crash a plane? Well, maybe in those cases then, death penalty could be on the table. In most cases, it's not. Either way, criminal law is to protect society, proof has to be beyond a reasonable doubt, and it is to punish and deter. Which then brings us to civil law. You may also hear that referred to as tort law. Here, it's no longer society that's the victim. It can be individuals, groups, or organizations. And in civil law, proof must be the majority of the proof. Keyword here again, majority. You may also hear it as the preponderance of proof. It is more likely than not. Here, the punishment are financial fines, and they're there to compensate the victim or victims. As the next type of laws, we have administrative or regulatory laws. And they're made by government agencies. In the US, that could be the FDA or FAA, something like that. They're made by government agencies. An example of this could be HIPAA. We just talked about that one. That was the one that in the US protect the individual's medical records and their protected health information. And then we have private regulations. I have already mentioned the PCI-DSS standard. That is the one where if anyone wants to issue or handle credit cards, they need to adhere to that standard. If they don't, they lose the right to issue the credit cards. It is not a law. It is an industry standard where all the payment card processors in the US came together and made the PCI-DSS standard, both because they needed to be a standard, and I think also because they didn't want the government to interfere. If they built a strong enough standard, there would be no point for the government to make regulations. The first four types of laws and regulations, I think it's possible you can see on the exam. The second two here, maybe not so much, but I would still be aware of them. They are customary law and religious law. If you are somewhere where this is used, this is something you need to know how to adhere to. Customary law is focused on the personal conduct and patterns of behavior, and it's founded in the traditions and the customs of that area or that region. And religious law, again, is the religious belief in a certain area or a certain region, and they most often include a code of ethics and moralities that are required to be upheld. And since knowing the laws, regulations, and rules in your area is part of your job, you need to very clearly understand which laws, rules, and regulations you need to adhere to in the area and the country that you're in, so you can make sure you do the best job possible. When we talked about privacy, I mentioned there were some laws and regulations that partially or completely focuses on privacy. Now, let's look at some of those. And most of these are going to be from the US. You may take the exam outside of the US, and it is an international certification, but it is primarily made by people from the US, so it is going to focus more on US law versus other countries. First off, we have HIPAA, and that is the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. And this is a law on how health information is handled in the US, and it has very strict privacy and security rules for handling PHI. And that is not PII, that is protected health information. Now, that doesn't mean that it can't be used to identify you with. Some of it could be personal identifiable information. And be very clear here, it is protected health information. It's not private, it's not personal, it is protected. The law applies to health insurers, providers, and clearinghouse agents. Those are the ones that handle the claims. And in HIPAA, we have three rules: a privacy rule, a security rule, and a breach notification rule. And they are exactly what they sound like. Privacy: you have a right for your information to be protected. Your health information needs to be kept private. With the security rule, the companies who handle PHI have to implement appropriate security measures And then obviously the breach notification rule. If they are breached, if the data is leaked, well, then they have to let the public know. And the breach notification is sort of a big thing because in the US, in all 50 states, we have security breach notification laws. But what that really means and how much or how little it is depends on the state. Normally, they would require the state to inform anyone if the PII has been compromised. But many of them also have an encryption clause, meaning if a company lost the records of, let's say, 100,000 people, but they had the data encrypted, and if we assume the encryption is strong enough, in some places that's kind of vague, then they might not have to notify anyone. So when you watch the news and you see someone who lost 5,000 or 10,000 or 150 million social security numbers, those are the ones that were not encrypted. So we can probably safely assume that many, many more are compromised. Next up, we have the ECPA, the Electronics Communication Privacy Act. This one is a little bit older and was intended to protect electronic communication against warrantless wiretapping. And I say intended because the Patriot Act in 2001 weakened it so much to a point where it doesn't really matter, which is a good segue to talk about the Patriot Act. It drastically expanded on law enforcement's electronic monitoring capabilities. Before the Patriot Act, if the police wanted to monitor someone's phone activity, they would have to get a warrant for that one circuit, meaning if Bob talked to John, they can monitor him on that one line. With the Patriot Act, they get a blank authorization for that one person. They can monitor all communication to and from that person with a single warrant. The Patriot Act also allows ISPs, those are the internet service providers, the ones where you get your internet connection through, it allows them and requires them to hand over any private information of their customers. And then finally, the Patriot Act eases the restriction on foreign intelligence gathering within the US. And the last one we have here is the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, CFAA. And this is where most cybercrimes are prosecuted. And this was made in 1986. Since this has been a long time ago, there's been maybe 8 or 10 amendments since then. I don't think you need to know any of the amendments. Maybe just know that the Patriot Act was one of them, and that was in 2001. And in 2008, they added the Identity Theft Enforcement and Restitution Act. And then finally, we have PCI-DSS. This is another one we've talked about before. It is not a law. It's a standard that the entire credit card payment industry has agreed upon, meaning anyone who wants to issue credit or debit cards have to adhere to the standard and a minimum set of security requirements. And this mandates security policies, devices, control techniques, and monitoring. And with that, we are done with this lecture. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next one.